वेलकम टू ई लेक्चर सीरीज फॉर बीटेक फोर्थ सेम द सब्जेक्ट डाटा कम्युनिकेशन एंड कंप्यूटर नेटवर्क्स। मायसेल्फ प्रकाश मीना, असिस्टेंट प्रोफेसर कंप्यूटर साइंस एंड इंजीनियरिंग डिपार्टमेंट, इंजीनियरिंग कॉलेज अजमेर। वी हैव टूडेज टॉपिक इज HTTP. HTTP स्टैंड फॉर हाइपर टेक्स्ट ट्रांसफर प्रोटोकॉल। Nowadays the internet, or you can say web, so the rapid growth in the use of the web is due to the standardization of all the elements that support web applications. So the key element of internet is HTTP, which is the protocol for the exchange of the web-based information between web browsers and web servers. Three types of intermediate devices can be used in an HTTP networks: first proxies, second gateways, and third tunnels. All this we discuss in this lecture. And HTTP uses request and response style of communication, just like client and server architecture. Now, how to access the web? The HTTP is the key. Hypertext Transfer Protocol is a foundation protocol of the World Wide Web and can be used in any client and server application involving hypertext. Sometimes misleading that HTTP is not a protocol for transferring hypertext, rather it is a protocol for transmitting information with the efficiency necessary for making hypertext jumps. The data transferred by the protocol can be plain text, hypertext, audio, image, or any internet accessible information. Here, the most recent versions like Internet Standard Track HTTP 1.1, RFC 2616 discussed. Here, a number of important terms defined in the HTTP specifications are summarized in table. First one is the cache. Cache, a program, a local store of response messages and the subsystem that controls its message storage, retrieval and deletion. A cache stores cacheable responses in order to reduce the response time and network bandwidth consumptions on future equivalent request. Any client or server may include a cache, though a cache cannot be used by a server while it is acting as a tunnel. So it is the part of mostly client related. And a client, an application program that establishes connection for the purpose of sending requests. Thus, third one is connection, a transport layer virtual circuit established between two application program for the purpose of communication. Here, entity, a particular representation or rendition of a data resource or reply from a service resource that may be enclosed within a request or response message. So an entity consists of an entity header and entity body. Now, gateway, a server that acts as an intermediary for some other servers. Unlike a proxy, a gateway receives requests as if it were the original server for the requested resources. It is like dummy. The requesting clients may not be aware that it is communicated with a gateway. Gateways are often used as server-side portals through network firewalls and as a protocol translator for access to resources stored on non-HTTP systems. Message is basic unit of HTTP communication, consisting of a structured sequence of octets transmitted via the connections. Origin server, the origin server on which a given resource resides and is to be created. Now proxy, an intermediary program that acts as both a server and a client for the purpose of making requests on behalf of the other clients. Requests are serviced internally or bypassing them with possible translation onto the other servers. A proxy must interpret and, if necessary, rewrite a request message before forwarding it. Proxies are often used as client-side portal through network firewalls, as we discussed or mentioned earlier, and as a helper applications for handling requests via protocols not implementing by the user agent. Resource: a network data object or service which can be identified by a URL is called or URI as a resource. Then next is server, an application program that accepts connections in order to service requests by sending back responses. Now tunnel, an intermediary program that is acting as a blind relay between two connections. Once active, a tunnel is not considered a party to the HTTP communication. Though the tunnel may have been initiated by an HTTP request, a tunnel ceases to exist when both ends of the relayed connections are closed. Tunnels are used when a portal is necessary and the intermediary cannot or should not interpret the relayed communication. Next, last one is the user agent, the client that initiates a request. These are often browsers, editors, spiders, and other end user tools. Now, HTTP overview. HTTP is a transaction oriented client server protocol. The most typical use of HTTP is between a Brave browser and web server. To provide reliability, HTTP makes use of TCP. Nevertheless, HTTP is a stateless protocol. Each transaction is treated independently. Accordingly, a typical implementation will create a new TCP connection between client and server for each transaction and then terminate the connection as soon as the transaction completes. Although the specification does not dictate this one-to-one relationship between transaction and connection lifetime. Another important feature for HTTP is it is flexible in the format that it can handle. When a client issues a request to a server, it may include a prioritized list of formats that it can handle, and the server replies with the appropriate format. There is an example: Linux browser cannot handle images, so a web server need not transmit any images on web pages. This arrangement or such type of arrangement prevents the transmission of unnecessary information and provides the basis for extending the set of formats with a new standardized and proprietary specifications. Here are some examples of HTTP operations. Here you can see the first diagram. There are three examples of HTTP operations. First simplest case is one in which a user agent establishes a direct connection with an origin server. As you can see on figure first, the user agent is the client that initiates the request, and such as the web browser being run on behalf of an end user. The origin server is the server on which a resource of the interest resides. An example is a web server at which a desired web home page resides. Here, when the server receives the request, it attempts to perform the requested action and then returns an HTTP response. The response includes status information, a success error code, and a MAME-like message containing information about the server. MAME means MIME like message. Information about the response itself, and it's include possible bodies contained. The TCP connection is then closed. Second diagram shows the middle part in which there is not end-to-end TCP connection between the user agent and the origin server. Instead, there are one or more intermediate system with TCP connections between logically adjacent system. Each intermediate system acts as a relay so that a request initiated by client is relayed through the intermediate system to the server, and the response from the server is relayed back to the client. There are three forms of intermediate systems are defined in the HTTP specification. First, proxies, gateways, internal. We see in next slide, and the third one is will be discussed later. So here the three forms of intermediate systems are defined like proxies, gateways, and tunnel. So first, proxies, you can see in diagram there is HTTP request and HTTP request over authenticated connections and TCP connections. Okay, in proxy, a proxy acts on behalf of other clients and present requests from other clients to a server. The proxy acts as a server in interacting with a client and as a client in interacting with a server. There are two scenario that call for the use of a proxy. First one, security intermediary. The client and server may be separated by a security intermediary such as a firewall with the proxy on the client side of the firewall. Typically the client is the part of a network secured by a firewall and the server is external to the secured network. So in this case, the server must authenticate itself to the firewall to set up a connection with the proxy. The proxy accepts responses after they have passed through the firewall. The second case is different version of HTTP. If the client and servers are running different versions of HTTP, then the proxies can implement both versions and perform the required mapping. In short, a proxy is a forwarding agent receiving a request for a URL object, modifying the request and forwarding the request toward the server identified in the URL. Next figure is the gateway. You can see the gateway, intermediary and HTTP request with authenticated and non-HTTP request also. A gateway is a server that appears to the clients as if it were an origin server. It acts on behalf of other servers that may not be able to communicate directly with the client. There are two scenarios in which gateways can be used. First one is security intermediary. The client and server may be separated by a security intermediary such as firewall with the gateway on the server side of the firewall. Typically the server is connected to a network protected by a firewall with the client external to the network. In this case, the client must authenticate itself to the gateway, which can then pass the request on to the server. The second scenario, non-HTTP server. Web browser have built into them the capability to contact server for protocol other than HTTP, such as FTP, Gopher servers. This capability can also be provided by a gateway. The client makes an HTTP request to a gateway server. The gateway server then contacts the relevant FTP or Gopher server to obtain the desired result. This result is then converted into a form suitable for HTTP and transmitted back to the client. Now the third figure shows tunnel. As you can see, there is only a tunnel between agent and server, and directly a HTTP request. So unlike the proxy and the gateway, the tunnel performs no operations on HTTP requests and responses. Instead, a tunnel is simply a relay point between two TCP connections and the HTTP messages are HTTP messages are passed unchanged, as if there were a single HTTP connection between user agent and origin server. Tunnels are used when there must be an intermediary system between client and server, but it is not necessary for that system to understand the content of messages. Now we can back to our previous slide. Here there is the last one. There is a request chain and response chain. So it is related to cache. So the lowest portion of the figure is cache, and cache is a facility that may store previous requests and responses for handling new requests. If a new request arrives, that is the same as stored request, then the cache can supply the stored response rather than accessing the resource indicated in the URL. The cache can operate on a client or server or on an intermediate system other than a tunnel. In the figure, intermediary B has cached a request response transaction so that a corresponding new request from the client need not travel the entire chain to the origin server but is handled by the P. Not all transactions can be cached, and a client or server can dictate that a certain transaction may be cached only for a given time limit. Now we go to next slides. General structure of HTTP messages. Here you can see that there is a normal structure for HTTP. First, request line or status line. Second one is general header. Third one is request header or response header, entity header, and then last one is entity body. The best way to describe the functionality of HTTP is to describe the individual element of the HTTP message. So HTTP consists of two types of messages: request from the client to server and response from server to client. The general structure of such messages in, as already you saw here in diagram, and there are some BNF Baker's norm forms notation format also you can see in next slide. Augmented BNF notation used in URL and HTTP specification. So you can see here some rules related to words in lowercase. Rule has the form for name is equal to definition, and digit is any decimal digit. Here are some symbols and some special symbols. Here square brackets use include optional elements, and constructed hash is used to define with the following form. Okay, and the last one is a semicolon at the right of a rule start a comment that continues to the end of the line. Now we discussed messages in details. The best way to describe the functionality in HTTP, the individual element of HTTP, and as we know that there are two types of messages: request from the client and server, and responses from the server to the client. The format for messages here: HTTP message, simple request, simple response, full request, full response. There is entity body. There are entity body again. There is a general header and get command, and last one is the simple response entity body. So here are some basic fields like with full requests and responses. The following fields are used. Before that, we can some discuss about get command also. So the simple request and simple response messages were defined in HTTP 0.9. The request is a simple get command with the requested URL. The response is simply a block containing the information identified in the URL. In the HTTP 1.1, the use of this simple form is discouraged because it prevents the client from using content negotiation and the server from the identifying the media type of the returned entity. Here some fields. First one is request line. Identifies the message type and the requested resource. Second one is status line. It provides status information about this response. Third, general header contains fields that are applicable to both request and response messages but that do not apply to the entity being transferred. Fourth one is request header, contains information about the request and the client. Next one is response header, contains information about the response. Then next, entity header, contains information about the resource identified by the request and information about the entity body. The last one is the entity body, the body of the message. And again, I want to say that something about HTTP. The all of the HTTP headers consist of a sequence of fields following the same generic format as RFC 822. Each field begins on a new line and consists of the field name followed by a colon and the field value. Although the basic transaction mechanism is simple, there is a large number of fields and parameters defined in HTTP RFC 822. So the slide contains some materials from William Stallings and the book Data Computer and Communication 8th edition. Okay, thank you.